Welcome dear friends. Today's video is about a very important and a very basic concept from the Indian Contracts Act. Yes, you guessed it right. We are discussing contract and the essential elements of a valid contract in the present video. My name is Professor Vani. Without much delay, let us get into the topic. Let's start from the beginning. Let us first understand what a contract is and how it is defined in the Indian Contracts Act. When somebody asks you what a contract is, the first thing that would come to your mind would be an agreement. Yes, of course, you are right. A contract is an agreement. However, it should possess some essential elements so that it can be called as a contract. Let's see how it is defined in the Indian Contracts Act. Section 2, subsection H of Indian Contracts Act defines contract as an agreement enforceable by law. Upon a careful analysis of this definition, we find that there are two parts to this definition. One, there should be an agreement, and two, it should be enforceable by law. Let us take a look at both these parts one after another. Let's begin with the agreement. Now, again, agreement is a very, very usual term, very common term which we use in our daily language. When somebody says agreement, what comes to our mind again is two people concurring upon a certain thing, certain idea, both of them agreeing upon something. Let's see how it is defined in the Indian Contracts Act. Section 2, subsection E defines agreement as every promise and every set of promises forming consideration for each other, that is known as an agreement. Now, this brings us to another equation wherein agreement is equal to promise. So, section 2, subsection E terms agreement as a promise. Maybe there could be only one promise made by one party to another party, or there could be two promises exchanged mutually by the parties to each other. So, the promise would result into an agreement. Once a promise is made, it becomes binding upon both the parties to fulfill what they have promised to each other. Hence, a promise is an agreement, in fact. Now, this leads us to another terminology called as promise, which again is a very, very common term. We keep using it very regularly. Now, promise, usually we refer to it as a word given by one person to another person. Let us see how it is defined in the Indian Contracts Act again. Section 2, subsection B defines promise as an accepted proposal. Now, again upon analysis, what we find is promise results when there is an offer made by one person and that offer is accepted by that other person to whom the offer is made. Say, for example, Mr. A says, would you buy my car for a certain amount of money? And B accepts, yes, I would buy your car. Then this becomes a promise because an offer has been made and that offer has been accepted by the person to whom that offer is made. So going by the definition here, what we understand is promise arises when there is an offer and it is accepted. We also learned just now that an agreement arises when there is a promise made. So this leads us to a conclusion that agreement would arise when an offer is accepted. That means we can put it in the form of an equation here. Agreement is equal to offer plus acceptance. Now let us just have recollect what are the things that we have learned till now. We understood that a contract is an agreement enforceable by law, that there should be an agreement and it should be enforceable by law. Now, what is an agreement? Agreement is equal to a promise. Now, what is a promise? Promise arises when there is an offer and that offer has been accepted. So, therefore, we concluded that agreement is equal to offer plus acceptance. Now, look at the following situations here. Mr. A wanted to sell a car. He is an owner of two cars, one a red car and another is a green car, and he offers to sell his red car to B, without mentioning which particular car. B accepts to buy the car, assuming that green car is being offered. So there is an offer, there is an acceptance, but do you think there is an agreement arising between the both parties? Obviously not. What could be the reason? While one party is thinking of selling red car, the other party is thinking of buying the green car. So that means they are not concurring upon an idea. This is called as absence of consensus ad idem. Now what ad idem? When both parties to the agreement think about the same subject in the same manner and in the same sense, then we say that they are at ad idem. In other words, consensus ad idem means meeting of the minds. Both the parties should be thinking about the same subject matter in the same subject matter in the same sense. Whereas in our previous example, while A was assuming, A wanted to sell the red car, B was assuming that he was buying green car, which clearly tells us there was a lack of consensus ad idem, hence no agreement had arisen there. So what we can understand from this entire discussion is that unless there is consensus ad idem, there can be no agreement. No doubt, there could be an offer and it could be accepted, but agreement can arise only when there is consensus ad idem between both the parties, that is, their minds are meeting. Now, is every agreement enforceable? See, when we understood the definition of contract, we understood that contract is an agreement enforceable by law. The first part of this definition, that is agreement, we understood. Let us come to the second part of it, that is enforceability by law. Do you think all agreements are enforceable by law? Are all agreements contracts? Look at these few situations here. Rani's mom promised to buy her a new mobile phone if she scores a good CGP. Now let us assume Rani worked hard and she scored a very good CGP and she demands the mobile phone which was promised to her. But her mother makes an excuse that she cannot buy it now, right now, and she would buy it on some other occasion. Rani is disappointed, but can she sue her mother? What would be your answer? Let us consider another situation. Your neighbor invited you to his wedding and you promised to attend without fail. But you are busy on that particular day, so you could not attend the wedding of your neighbor. So can your neighbor sue you? What would be your answer? Obviously, your answer would in both cases be no, a big no. See, every agreement is not enforceable by law. What we saw just now were the examples of agreements. One, in the case of Rani's mom's promise, it was a case of a domestic agreement. And in case of your neighbor inviting you for his wedding, was a social agreement. Both were agreements, but then they were not enforceable in the court of law. They had no value in the eyes of the court of law. Hence, law attaches no value to such agreements because they are very casually made between the parties and they lack enforceability. Now, when would an agreement be enforceable then? An agreement is enforceable by law if and if only it satisfies the conditions for enforceability as laid down by section 10. Let us see what section says about conditions for enforceability. It reads as follows. All agreements are contracts if they are made by free consent of parties competent to contract for a lawful consideration and with a lawful object and are not expressly declared to be void. Now, upon analysis of this statement, we understand that there are a few conditions imposed by the Indian Contracts Act which an agreement should possess or should satisfy, then only it can become a valid contract. You can see here there should be free consent of the parties. Two, parties must be competent to contract. Three, there should be a lawful consideration which supports the promise. And the object of the contract should be a lawful one and it should not be expressly declared as void. Let us understand these conditions in detail. Apart from these five or six conditions which are laid down by section 10, we will add a few more which we can find again in the Indian Contracts Act only, and together we will discuss them under nine different heads, okay, which go as follows. Number one, offer and acceptance. Two, intention to create a legal relationship. Three, lawful consideration. Four, capacity to contract. Five, free consent. Six, lawful object. 7. Agreement not expressly declared as void. 8. certainty and possibility of performance, and finally, ninth one, legal formalities to be fulfilled. Let us look at each of these elements. Let's begin with the first element, a very basic element which is required for a contract to arise. Mind you, we are discussing the essential elements of a valid contract. The very basic requirement is, first one is offer and acceptance. Section 2 subsection A talks about offer, section 2 subsection B talks about acceptance. Now, already we have seen how significant offer and its acceptance is so as to give rise to an agreement. This shows us that for a contract to arise, essentially there should be two parties. And what are the parties known as? When an offer is made, the person making the offer is called as offerer. The person to whom it is made would be known as offeree. And if he accepts the offer, he would become an acceptor. And how should the offer be? The offer must be definite and unambiguous so that it can give a clear idea as to what is being offered. How should acceptance be? Acceptance must be absolute and unconditional. So that means when the final acceptance is given, when the final bargain is struck after initial negotiations and all, that is when the agreement would arise. Okay. So offer should be definite. Like for example, if you say, I would like to buy a liter of oil, supply me a liter of oil, without mentioning which kind of oil you are asking for, this leads to a lot of confusion, a lot of ambiguity, because you are not mentioning which kind of oil. So such an offer is not a valid offer and would never result into an agreement even when accepted. So offer should be definite and unambiguous. Acceptance must be absolute and unconditional. The second essential. The second essential is intention to create legal relationship. Now it's not just enough if the parties enter into agreement. Both the parties must intend to bind each other legally, such that if there is a failure by any one of the parties to fulfill the obligation arising under the agreement, the other party, that is a suffering party, can always take a recourse to legal action. That is when we say the parties are intending to create legal relationship between each other. For example, here we can discuss one very leading case, that is Balfour versus Balfour, wherein a husband promised to pay his wife a monthly allowance of £30 to take care of her household expenses. But upon separation, the husband stopped to pay that amount and the wife sued him in the court of law for claiming the amount promised. But the court gave a judgment here that no, there is no obligation on the husband to make the payment, because when the parties had that agreement, when the husband and wife had that agreement, they never had this intention to bind each other legally. Hence, it was not a contract, it was only an agreement which was of a domestic nature. Now, how do we know whether such an intention is present or not present? Either they agree it verbally or in the written form, or if nothing is agreed upon expressly, then the general presumption of law is that in all commercial transactions, an intention to create legal relationship is always present. So the bottom line here is, in social agreements and domestic agreements, usually there is no such intention and hence they are not binding. Whereas if they are commercial agreements or business agreements, then they are binding, because there is a general presumption that in all commercial transactions, the parties intend to bind each other legally. Moving on, essential element number 3, that is lawful consideration. Now, section 2 subsection D defines lawful consideration, which we will look when we discuss in detail about consideration, which we will cover it in some other video. Section 25 of Indian Contracts Act also very clearly mentions that where there is no consideration, there is no contract. Now, what do we understand by this? Consideration means something in return. See, contract is a win-win situation. Both the parties should benefit out of the contract. If you buy a pen, you pay money, you pass the benefit in the form of money, and you get the benefit in the form of a pen. So both the parties involved should get some benefit. So that benefit which is returned in return for a promise is called as consideration. Now, how should consideration be? It could be cash or kind. It may be an act, abstinence, or a return promise. It may be past, present, or future. That means form of consideration does not matter. Timing of consideration does not matter. What matters actually is that there should be some benefit or something which supports the promise. Usually it is referred to as quid pro quo, which is a Latin term, which means something in return. So this brings us to an understanding that every contract should be supported by a valid consideration, lawful consideration, which has some value in the eyes of law. It could be in any form. However, it should be lawful. Moving on, the fourth essential element is capacity of the parties. That means the parties to contract should be competent to contract. Anybody and everybody cannot enter into a contract. Section 11 clearly says that every person is eligible to contract if he is of the age of majority, of a sound mind, and is not disqualified from contracting by law to which he is subject. That means he should not be a minor, he should not be a person of unsound mind, and he should not be disqualified by any law to which he is subject. So if a party suffers from any flaw in capacity, the agreement would not be enforceable. For example, an agreement by minor is void ab initio. More upon capacity to contract we will cover in some other video. For the time being, we will understand that the capacity arises if a person is of major age, and if he is of a sound mind, and if he is not disqualified by law to which he is subject. The next essential element is free consent. It means we understood already that the offer should be accepted by the person to whom the offer is made. When he gives his acceptance, we say he has given his consent. Now the consent which is given should be free consent. That means he should have given it out of his own free will and wish. Now if you remember, we discussed a term called as consensus ad idem, which means that both the parties are of the same mind on all material terms of the contract. We say consent is given, which is discussed under section 30. But what is actually required is free consent. And section 14 says there is absence of free consent if it is induced by coercion, a physical pressure, undue influence, a kind of a moral pressure or a mental pressure, fraud, that means either a wrong statement or a false statement or hiding of facts causing the other party to give his consent. Misrepresentation again is a wrong statement made, however, unintentionally without any intention to cheat. Mistake where there is an error of understanding. These are the five circumstances when there is no free consent. There could be consent, but the consent is not free consent. It is induced by any of these five things. If any such a flaw in the consent is present, then we say there is no free consent and a valid contract would not arise. To the next essential element, which is lawful object. Object means the purpose or design of the contract, the aim, the reason for which you are entering into contract. Indian Contracts Act says the object of every contract should be lawful. In fact, section 23 very clearly mentions every agreement of which the object or consideration is unlawful is void. So it is essential that the purpose of the contract should be lawful. In fact, Indian Contracts Act gives freedom to the parties to make promises to each other and fulfill those obligations which they make to each other, the promises which they make to each other. However, this freedom has certain limitations. The parties can make promises to each other within the legal framework as provided by the law. So, the object of the contract should be very much legal. And we say, in fact, the law says the object must not be illegal, the object must not be immoral, and the object must not be opposed to public policy. This is when we say the object is lawful. The object would be considered as unlawful if it is illegal, if it is immoral, or if it is opposed to public policy, that is, causing some harm or danger to the general public's welfare. Essential element number 7. It says the agreement shall not be expressly declared as void. In the Indian Contracts Act, at several places under several sections, expressly declares certain agreements as being void ab initio, that is void from the beginning. That means they lack legal recognition, they are destitute of legal effects. Few examples we would discuss here. A wagering agreement is void ab initio. Wagering agreement means an agreement involving gamble, and gamble is never encouraged by law. Hence, wagering agreements are considered to be, are declared to be in fact, void ab initio. Similarly, minors agreements. We just now understood that a person should be competent to enter into contract. Here, a minor is not eligible to enter into contract. So, if at all a minor enters into any agreements, such agreements would be void ab initio. Likewise, at several places in the Indian Contracts Act, under several sections, certain agreements have been expressly declared to be void. So, if you want your agreement to be a contract, it should not be one among them. Okay, if an agreement is expressly declared as void, it can never ever be a contract. So, an agreement which is not expressly declared as void can only be a contract. Moving ahead, essential element number 8, certainty and possibility of performance. Let us split this into two parts and understand one after another. First, let us talk about the certainty. The contract to be able to be performed should be certain enough. That means both the parties are clear as to what has been promised and what is to be done, what is the obligation, what has to be performed. So, if the agreement must not be vague or indefinite, that means if there is vagueness or if there is ambiguity, then it becomes difficult for the contract to be performed. Hence, the basic requirement is that, one of the requirements is that there should be certainty between the parties, what is being agreed. For example, say an agreement to purchase a motor car on higher purchase terms without deciding on the terms would be totally vague. Just agreeing that I will buy a car on higher purchase terms would not be enough unless until you decide upon what would be the down payment, how many number of installments, what would be the each installment and what would be the rate of interest, so on and so forth. Without discussing any of these terms, without finalizing upon any of these terms, if you simply say higher purchase terms, then that is too vague to be understood. It cannot be a valid contract. So, certainty is required. Secondly, possibility of performance is also very much required for a promise or for an agreement to become a contract. See, promises can be fulfilled if only they are capable of performance. They can be performed if they are capable of performance, if there is a possibility of performing. So, an agreement to do impossible acts is void in itself. See, how can you perform something which is impossible? Say, A agrees to put life into the dead body of B's wife against payment of money. Then this is an impossible agreement. It is not possible to put life back into the dead body. Hence, such an agreement would be void ab initio. When we talk about possibility of performance, we have to look at it from both the angles. It should be physically possible to perform. Two, it should also be legally possible to perform. Sometimes an agreement could be physically possible to perform. Say, for example, A had promised to deliver certain goods to B. However, those goods are banned. The import of such goods are banned. Though it is physically possible to deliver the goods even by smuggling, however, smuggling is strictly prohibited by law, so legally it is not possible. Hence, possibility should be in both terms, both physically possible as well as legally possible. The 9th essential element is about legal formalities. Now, let us understand one thing, that a contract could be oral or written. It is not necessary that a contract should always be in the written form only. It may be oral. Sometimes, some legal formalities may be prescribed by the law. So wherever any statutory requirement is prescribed, like say for example, the contract should be put on the paper, the contract should be signed by the parties, or it should be properly registered. In such cases, fulfilling those formalities, legal formalities, is mandatory. If such formalities are not fulfilled, then the agreement would be known as unenforceable contract. In fact, there is nothing wrong about it. There is nothing wrong in the contract as such. The only thing is, since the formalities are missing, the prescribed formalities are missing, it would be only unenforceable contract. We term such a contract as a contract with a technical defect. Now, say a check without the signature of the issuing party. Everything else is written properly. There is proper date, proper amount mentioned both in figures and words. Okay, only thing missing is the signature of the party. So, lack of signature of the issuing party would make it invalid. But it is not void as such. It is unenforceable. There is a technical defect. This defect can be rectified. Just put the signature. If the issuing party puts a signature on that check, once again that check becomes a valid check. So, wherever legal formalities are prescribed, fulfilling these legal formalities is mandatory. Otherwise, it would only be called as an unenforceable contract with a technical defect. However, this technical defect can be removed and it can once again be made an enforceable contract. Now, finally, from this entire discussion, what we understand is law of contracts is neither the whole law of agreements, nor it is the whole law of obligations, but it is the law of those agreements which give rise to obligations, and those obligations which have their source in agreements. So we can conclude saying that all contracts are agreements, but all agreements are not contracts. Only those agreements which possess all the 9 essential elements which we discussed just now would be known as a contract. Even if any one of them is missing, it would not be considered as a valid contract. Thank you, dear friends. We will meet again in some other video with a very important topic. Thank you.